We're going to start out in Isaiah 53. And you can turn there. I'm just going to free preach tonight. You just try to keep along with me and the best you can. I'm just going to preach it tonight. First of all, we need to understand on this week that Jesus Christ, He bore our griefs. He carried our sorrows. He was wounded for your transgressions, bruised for our iniquities, for our peace was upon Him. Very clearly, I start this message tonight saying, that was all done for you. Worthy is the Lamb that was slain. He was pierced for transgressions, wounded for our transgressions, and He bore our very grief on that cross. Amen?
Amen.
Also moving forward, Isaiah 53:6 says it this way, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Every one of us played a part in the very crucifixion of Jesus Christ. Every one of us drove that stake in his arm. Every one of us had a part in the piercing in his side. Amen. Moving forward. John 15 and 13. No greater love has no one than this, than you laid down one's life for his friends. He died for you. He laid his life down for you. He was crucified for you. And no greater love is that. In Romans it says in chapter 5, the greatest demonstration of love to mankind was the very crucifixion of Jesus Christ. That he laid his life down for you. He said in that statement, I desire mercy and not sacrifice. I decide that mercy triumphs over justice. And I am a long-suffering God. Amen?
Amen.
He also goes on to say in Ephesians 2:4, God, who is rich in his mercy, because of his great love, which he loved us. Even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive, alive, alive in Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
So we clarify that. We clarify that he bore our grief. He bore our iniquity. He was worthy. He was the Lamb that was slain for all of the sins that we committed. He bore it on that cross for you. This resurrection weekend is for you, for you, for you. Amen?
Amen.
It goes on to say, if you turn to me Romans chapter 5, verse 8, we will take a look at what the Word of God says is the very greatest demonstration of love. And we will end this section of the message with Romans chapter 5, verse 8. Here we go. We'll start verse 6. Christ in our place. For when we were still without strength in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrated his own love towards us, and while we were still sinners, while we were still drug addicts, while we were still hooked to pornography, he said, Christ died for all of you. Amen?
Amen.
He came and he died for you. So settle that there. He came and he washed you clean if you believe and put your faith in the suffering Savior. He washed you as clean and as white as snow. Hallelujah to Jesus. It goes on to say, that was the greatest demonstration of love. And we are forever grateful for the crucifixion of Jesus Christ. So we move on. Good Friday and the resurrection weekend says three things, guys. Stay here. Three things. Father, Son, Holy Spirit, true God. Three things it also says is our Lord desires mercy and not sacrifice. Matthew 9 and 13. Our Lord is long-suffering, wishing none shall perish. 2 Peter 3 and 9. Mercy triumphs over justice. James 2 and 13. Freedom bought and paid for by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
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 Jesus is good. Bought and paid for by the precious blood of Jesus Christ. You cannot work your way to heaven. It will not work. You have to come through the cross. Not only to it, but you must come through it. Now the greatest demonstration of love was him dying and sacrificing his life on the cross. Now when Simon the Cyrene came, and he came and Jesus was on his way to the cross, to the hill of skulls, and he came and he got up under that cross and he bore the cross with Jesus Christ. That was the very demonstration that man must partake for our Savior. Amen? You must get under that cross. You must bear the cross of Jesus Christ. Jesus said, lose your life now, gain it later. Gain your life now, lose it later. Amen? Get under that cross. Bear it for Christ. He is worthy. It goes on to say, mercy triumphs over justice. This weekend was all about you. It was about you, and about you. He died for you. He came for one reason, to die. And it says he remained obedient to the Father's will to the point of death. He humbled himself for you. God came off his throne. God came to die and bleed for you. It goes on to say in John 10:17, therefore my Father loves me, because I laid down my life that I may take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of myself. I have the very power to lay it down, and I have the very power to take it up again. This command I have received from my Father. Jesus says plainly, all this for you. He says, I laid down my very life for you. He said, nobody came and strong-armed me and took me to the cross. I allowed it to happen for you. Amen?
Amen.
He said, that's the greatest demonstration of love that you will ever receive. And I say this in the power of the Holy Spirit right now. If you're struggling and you just have pride and you can't love somebody or do this or do that, you're not living this life as a Christian to please yourself and be prideful. If Jesus says, love your neighbor as yourself, love him as yourself. If he says, love your wife as Christ loved the church, love her as he loved the church. Amen?
Amen.
We need to start doing these things. God's dealing with all of us in so many ways. He is worthy. It is not your show. It is God's show. If you're a Christian, amen? He died and suffered on the very cross for all of you. He is worthy for your obedience. Obedience is love to God. Taking up your cross, striving for Jesus. He is very worthy. He is very worthy to be praised. It goes on to say in Mark 10:45, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life a ransom for many. He came to pay the wage for our sins. He came to be the ransom. He came to purchase you as a purchase, eternal possession, to spend it in the glory with the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He came for no other reason but to die, to brutally die and die for you. And this weekend is all about you in the eyes of Christ. Will you receive this precious gift? Will you receive the freedom of Christ? Is it worth the cost of your life? Will you come not only to it, the cross, but will you get on it with him? You understand, to be a true Christian, it says that you must be crucified with Christ. Amen? Amen. You need to take Jesus off the cross and truly put yourself on the cross. And then Jesus will shine and live in your life. Amen?
Amen.
That's resurrection weekend. Be raised with Christ. Hallelujah. Moving on. It goes on to say, Christ makes it clear no one took his life. He laid it down for every one of you. And I'm going to start off with Peter in the Garden of Gethsemane. Remember in the garden when Judas, the devil entered into Judas, and they came and our Lord was praying, and then he came and the soldiers showed up in the garden. You all remember this? Amen?
Amen.
And they went to take him, and Jesus says, who are you looking for? They said, Jesus. He says, he am I am he. Then it says the soldiers were hit and they fell back on the ground, and then they got up, and who are you looking for? He says, I am he. And he gave himself into their hands. He blasted them with that power to say, you can't take me, I'm going to let you. Amen?
Amen?
Hallelujah. Peter pulls out his sword, cuts the soldier's ear off. Jesus says, live by the sword, die by the sword. And Jesus says to him, if you stay with it, Jesus says right to Peter in Matthew 16:22. Then Peter took him, lost my spot, but I'm going to stay with it. Let me just get back where I was. Okay, it's Matthew 26:54. He says to Peter in response, Peter's cutting the soldier's ear off. He says, or do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father and he will provide with me more than 12 legions of angels? You hear what he's saying? I can stop this whole thing right now, but I have to come and die for you. He said, nobody takes my life lest I lay it down. Hallelujah. He said, I can make one call or command to my Father and back out of this thing and have legions of angels come down and strike these very men dead and be saved from the wrath to come for our sin. But he said, I must remain. And he asked you to remain in his love. He died in his love for you. Verse 26 and 53 continues. Jesus says, how then could the scripture be fulfilled that it must happen thus, that he must die for you? This weekend is all about you, all about death and resurrection for you. Jesus says, if I step out of this thing, the scriptures will not be fulfilled and the will of the Father will not be carried out. And his will was, he wishes that none shall perish, but that all come to repentance. Moving forward with another display of Christ laying it down. It says in Matthew 27:42, when he was on the cross, he was on the very cross. We've all seen it. Here it is. He was on the very cross, and they came up to him and they mocked him. And they said, he saved others. Why don't he come off the cross? Why don't he save himself? Why don't he save himself? They didn't understand. Christ could have saved himself. He could have called the legion of angels. He wasn't taking himself off the cross because he came to die for you, and for you. Amen?
Amen.
He had to stay on that very cross. He was on there. He saved others. Why won't he save himself? Because he had to remain for your and I's filthy sin and rebellion against God. Because Isaiah 53 says we've all like sheep have gone astray and turned all of us to our own way. Amen? Yeah. He had to stay. It goes on to say in Matthew 16:22, another example of Christ clearly saying, nobody takes my life, I lay it down. Then Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, far be it from you, Lord. This is regarding Jesus telling them he must die. Peter said, it shall not happen to you, Peter says. But he turned and said to Peter, so Jesus says to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are an offense to me. For you are not mindful of the things of God, but you are mindful of the things of man. Amen? He said, Peter, you just don't understand this thing. You're seeing it carnally. You're not seeing it spiritually. And Satan is working through you because Satan would want nothing better than to stop Christ from going to the cross. So you die in your iniquity and there is no redemption. Amen? Amen. So he identified the spirit that was behind Peter and said, get behind me, Peter. I'm coming to die for my people. I'm coming to die for their name. I'm coming to raise them from the dead. Hallelujah. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let the spirit move in this place. Let it move. Let it move. Let it move, guys. This is reality. This is God. This is Christ, the Son of the living God, came and brutally died this weekend for all of us. We need to allow that to come into our heart. We need to allow that. Now, the prayer in the garden. We go on to know about the prayer in the garden. And some people have heard that Jesus was in such agony over going to the cross that he actually sweat blood. Okay? This was a heavy load for a sinless man to bear the sins of the world. To take on the very sins of the world. Every pornography flick you were watching. Every sexual perversion. Every child molestation. Every drug deal you ever made. Every filthy murderer, Jeffrey Dahmer, you name it. Was on that cross, was born on him, was laid on a sinless man. They say he was terrified of the crucifixion. Yes, he was man and God, or God and man in the flesh. But what really hurt God was that filthy feeling of that filthy sin that was laid on a holy God. Amen?
Amen.
He felt the agony and the burden of every dirty, vile sin we've ever committed was laid on the suffering Savior. You imagine that crucial hour, pure and holy, God himself. Bearing every dark deed you've ever done in the dark. Maybe a needle in your arm. Maybe a filthy thing. Everything. I'm not saying this to be mean. I'm saying it to show you and give you. The Holy Spirit wants you to feel the agony of Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
We're all responsible. It says in Matthew 14 and 35. He went a little farther and he fell on the ground and he prayed. That if it were possible, the hour night might pass from him. And he said, Abba, Father, all things are possible for you. Take this cup away from me. Nevertheless, not what I will, but what you will. And the Father didn't take the cup. Because the God the Father's will was for you to live eternally. Father, God's will was for you to receive mercy. Father, God's will was for mercy to triumph over justice. Father, God's love was greater. And he said, listen, you've all are bent on going your own way. But if you will turn unto me and come through that cross, you will forever be in glory with me. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
That's what he's saying. So we know that he prayed. This weekend is the greatest demonstration of love you will ever know. Your wife might love you, your husband might love you, your kids might give you good love, but this is the greatest demonstration of love that you will ever know. And the sad part about it is, a lot of people just live their life and they never are aware of the greatest demonstration of love, and they're never in that intimacy with Christ, and they pass them by and they die and they never experience what true love is in this world. Amen? Yeah. Christians know what true love is. Moving on to the king on the cross. In Mark 14 and 64, Jesus faces the Sanhedrin. So we see he decided to die for all of you. Amen. Now he's carrying it out. He said, Father, take the cup, but let your will be done. Now he's standing in front of the Sanhedrin in Mark 14:64. You have heard the blaspheme, the Sanhedrin said. What do you think? And they all condemned him to be deserving of death. Go figure, a man who knew no sin became sin for all of you. A man that never done sin, they said he is deserving of death. Go figure, in this dark and evil world, you want to be part of it? I'm out of it. I don't want nothing to do with the devil's world. Amen? They crucified a sinless man, God himself. And it goes on to say in Mark 14:16, then some began to spit on him. Some began to blindfold him. Some began to beat him and say to him, prophesy. And the officers struck him, and they took the very palms of their hand and blasted him in the face. They played blind man's bluff with the King of Kings. They blindfolded God himself and put a blindfold around his eyes and punched him in the face till the blood run down the face of the Lord Jesus Christ and said, prophesy now, who hit you? Who hit you? Conviction, guys. Holy Ghost. Let it come in you. Serve your God righteously. He is worthy. Not because he will love you more, but because we love him, because he is truly worthy. Amen?
Amen.
God help us. They punched the Lord Jesus Christ and prophesied, who hit you? They spat, human spat, in the face of God. Human spat in his face. For us, for you. This weekend is about you. Moving forward, Mark 15:15. Jesus goes on to face Pilate. Delivers Jesus up to Pilate. After he had scourged him to be crucified. Pilate gave him up to be crucified. Amen. Remember Barabbas, the murderer? They gave him an option who to free. And they said, free Barabbas, crucified God himself. And Pilate tried to find a way out but couldn't. And handed him up to be crucified. It goes on to say in Mark 15:15, he was delivered up to be scourged and to be crucified. The soldiers then mocked Jesus in Mark 15:16. Then the soldiers led him away into a place, the praetorium, and they called together the whole garrison and clothed him in purple, and they twisted a crown of thorns on his head, put on his head, and began to salute him, Hail, King of the Jews. They struck him on his head with a reed and spat on God. They looked over and said and bowed a knee, and they worshipped him. And when they had mocked him, they took the purple off him, put his clothes on him, and then led him to the cross to be crucified. Here again we see human spat in the face of God, the righteous Savior. Who rose the dead from the grave, who cleansed the lepers, who healed the sick, the greatest demonstration of love you ever know. Crucified him. Should feel it in your spirit, what he paid on this weekend. Whew. I say thank you to my God. They nailed him to the cross next. They pierced him in the side and crucified him. Let me explain what this was. The very word excruciating comes from out of the cross. Excruciating pain. and suffering and torment on that cross. It was not easy. You study the Roman crucifixion and how they used to do it and the methods. Sometimes they'd crucify you and lay you outside the city. Leave you there for weeks as an example of what happens when you go against Roman authority. You'd watch your very children and family rot and stink away. This was a brutal crucifixion. Not to mention these psychopathic dungeon killers that tormented and beat and killed people for a living in the planetarium or wherever the garrison was, in the dungeon that he was in. They beat and killed people. Beat some of them to death. And they used what was called a cat of nine tails. A cat of nine tails where, you know, glass and metal and whatever, and they take it, they take that cat of nine tails and they hit the Lord Jesus in the back and they pull the flesh off his skeleton. They've laid open the very back of the Lord Jesus Christ for you, and for you. He is worthy. He bore your iniquity. He bore your sin. Yet he went and he opened not his mouth. He was humble. As a sheep is led to the shears, he is silent. He went and did it for you. Is he worthy for maybe you to surrender something? Is he worthy for you to turn around and come for him? Is he worthy to be loved with all your heart, all your mind, and all your soul? I say amen. Hallelujah. Amen. It goes on to say, it is finished. After this, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, this is going to be John 19 and 28, that all things now are accomplished, that the scripture might be fulfilled, he said, I thirst. Now a vessel full of sour wine was sitting there, and they filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on hyssop, and put it in his mouth. So when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, it is finished. And bowing his head, he gave up his spirit. He died and said, guess what? It is finished. For you, and for you. Hallelujah. He died for you. He bore the cross for you. He is the only way to be free from your sins. I bind any spirit in this room right now that says there is another God before my suffering Savior, Jesus Christ. I know he's alive in me. I know as a convicted criminal, animalistic man, filthy, dirty, and stinking, that Christ came in and changed my life. And because of Christ in me, I'm a very changed man. Every ounce of glory goes to him. The only thing that I had done was heard his call and made the choice to hand the wheel over. And some of you tonight, you do have to make that choice. You have to take your hands off the wheel and let Jesus drive. Amen?
Amen.
Give your life to Christ. He is so worthy. It goes on to say in Isaiah 53, he was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before its shears is silent, so he opened not his mouth for you, and for you. Amen?
Amen.
The glory of God, the greatest demonstration you will ever know, is in Jesus. I say this weekend that we focus on the very cross of Christ. We focus at the empty tomb. But most importantly, we focus on the very resurrected Christ. The resurrection of Christ. Where Paul writes, if Christ went to the cross and just died and never rose, he died in vain and we are still dead in our sins. Amen? The resurrected Jesus of Nazareth. The resurrected God that is calling you. He is the very way. He is the only way. Now tonight, God wanted to bring you into step one. Thursday, we move on to the tomb and its glory. And our victory, O death, where is thou victory? O death, where is thou sting? The king overcame the grave.